Good morning, Saints. This is Brother Mike. Sunday morning podcast, 9 a.m. Mountain Time and 11 a.m. Eastern Time. Thank you for joining me this morning. This is the Deep Things of God with Brother Mike. And I've got an interesting Bible study for you today. I think you're going to find it fascinating with real life experiences attached to it. And wanted to remind you of our ministry, hardcorechristianity.com. You can go there and see all of our ministry services. We have two live Zoom deliverance services every week, Tuesday and Wednesday nights at 6 p.m. Mountain Time. Send me an email, mike@hardcorechristianity.com, and I'll send you the ID and the password for those two services. They are quite remarkable. Lots of healings, lots of deliverances. Then we have two live services every week, Thursday and Friday nights at the Arizona Deliverance Center. We're downtown on 15th Avenue, just south of Osborn Road. Those are at 7 p.m. Arizona and Mountain Time. Those two services are broadcast live on our streaming channels. One of them is our main channel, which is youtube.com/House of Healing AZ. You can catch those services live, and the healing and deliverance portion of the services are also included on our streaming channel. So you can watch the deliverances actually occurring. You can watch the healings actually occurring in real time, and you're good to go. Also on the website, on the homepage, you can catch all my local radio shows. I've been on the radio here in Maricopa County, Arizona for 20 years. And I'm on KXXT Christian Radio 1010. The main broadcast is every morning at 7:30, Monday through Friday. I'm also on 7 days a week. And the schedule is on the front of the homepage on the website. All right, let's get to our Bible study. Got some interesting information for you today. Take a look at Luke chapter 13. Pretty shocking section of text here. Quite remarkable. It says here, Jesus told him a parable. And he told him a parable of the fig tree. You remember that? Well, the short version of that parable is, this fig tree is not producing fruit. So the owner of the vineyard said, tear the thing down, get rid of it. And then the manager of the vineyard said, I'll tell you what, let's take a shot at salvaging this fig tree. We'll dig it up, fertilize it for a year or two. And then after that, if it doesn't produce any figs, what we'll do, we'll cut it down and get rid of it. All right. And then the Holy Spirit then illustrates that parable with a real life situation. Right after that parable, it says Jesus was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath day. Now remember, the Jews had a bunch of Sabbaths. The main Sabbath was on Saturday, but they had midweek Sabbaths and special Sabbaths and celebratory Sabbaths and so on. We don't know which Sabbath this was, but it kind of looks like it was the main Sabbath on a Saturday. Remember, Jesus was crucified on the cross of Calvary on the Sabbath, but that was a midweek Sabbath. He was crucified on a Wednesday, but traditionally they picked Friday, and then you've got Good Friday and all that stuff. That stuff was just all made up by religious people. It never actually happened. But it says here, behold, there was a woman in the synagogue that had a spirit of infirmity. Okay. Now the Greek word for infirmity there is asthenia. It's a generalized term for being weak or feeble. And it could encompass any kind of, you know, condition. It's not condition specific. It's a generalized term. Okay? But in this particular case, it looks like the disability was severe, because she had had it for 18 years, 19 years previous to this service in the synagogue and her meeting Jesus. she did not have the condition. But what happened was 19 years earlier, a spirit entered the woman's body, and it was a spirit of infirmity. Now, these demons are stubborn as they can be, and they cause a wide range of illnesses, sicknesses, diseases, disabilities, all of it. And once this spirit gets into the person's body, it doesn't have the power to instantly make them disabled or instantly kill them or instantly give them cancer to where it's so bad they die. It's a progressive system. It's a process where the demon gradually tears down the body. Now, if you see somebody with physical joint issues, almost 100% of those are spirits of infirmity. Rheumatoid arthritis, scoliosis, kyphosis, different joint disabilities. All those, in my experience over the years, have always been spirits of infirmity. Once you get the spirit out of there, the person recovers. And it says here, she had this condition for 18 years and she was bent over. The Greek word there is sunkupto. It means to stoop forward. So she was kind of a humpback, so to speak. And she could not stand up anymore, it says. Verse 12 says, well, Jesus took a look at her and he says to her, woman, you are loosed. Apoluo is the Greek word. It means to untie or unchain or release from being in bondage. You are loosed from your infirmity. Now notice this. When a spirit enters a person's body, could be an infirmity spirit, could be a lust demon, could be a spirit of addiction. Once that spirit enters your body, it has the condition that you now have. So you don't need the name of the demon or the name of the sickness to get that out of a person's body. You don't have to have that. You don't need to have the names of demons. You can get them out. No problemo. But this woman's condition was orthopedic. And he says to her, you are loosed from your infirmity. Same Greek word, asthenia. Instead of actually naming the illness, I don't even know if they had a name for that illness back then. I'm assuming they did. We would call it rheumatoid arthritis or kyphosis or something. And he laid his hands on her, and immediately she was made straight. Now that's the Greek word, anorthao, where we get our English word orthotics or orthopedic. An orthopedic surgeon technically is someone who straightens out your bones, so to speak. And that's what this is talking about. She was made straight. She suddenly just stood right up, which is a medical impossibility with that condition. And then she started glorifying God. Here you see the hidden secret of divine healing. The purpose of the healings are to glorify God. That's why you get healed. God does it because he loves you and he has compassion on you and cares about you. But the end result of your healing and God's love for you is that you are to glorify him. You are to let your praise go. Crank it out. Well, then something bad happened, and that's going to happen to you. If you decide, and I hope you do today, to develop within yourself a healing and deliverance ministry, which every born-again Christian can have who wants it and who will make sacrifices to receive it. Mark chapter 16, it says, these signs shall follow them that believe. They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Here you see a perfect example of what Jesus was training his disciples to do. The disciples were all standing around watching this event take place, and Jesus was demonstrating what he later on in Mark 16 and Matthew 28, he was going to tell them to do. So it was all OJT. It was 3 or 4 years of Jesus being here on the earth in his ministry, and he was putting his disciples the 12 disciples and all the other disciples. There were, you know, probably hundreds of them that were following him. He had them in an OJT program, on the job training. Well, if you do what God wants you to do, and you start to minister in the Spirit, and you start to develop a deliverance or healing ministry, which I hope you will, you got to remember something. The church is going to turn on you. And you have to be ready for that. You got to be ready for that. The church is going to turn on you. Okay? These demons that were in this poor woman got into her 19 years earlier, but I have seen numerous cases over the years where the spirits have gotten into wombs and entered into a fetus. And the fetuses are then born with congenital disabilities. Very common. It happens all the time. But these spirits can still be cast out, whether they got in the womb or whether they got in 19 years ago, or whether it got in 1 year ago, doesn't matter. The Holy Ghost is well able to smash this thing, no question. So this pastor gets on him, and he starts telling Jesus, the creator of the Sabbath, what not to do and to do on the Sabbath, not realizing that Jesus was the creator of the Sabbath and the Lord of the Sabbath. So he starts, you know, the janitor starts to tell the chief executive officer of the country, of the company, what to do. Here you go. You shouldn't be doing this. This should not be done on the Sabbath day. We have other days where you are to come and be loosed from your infirmities, but we don't do that on the Sabbath day. So anyway, this guy would have made a great phony fake TV preacher. Verse 16, Jesus said, "Wait a minute here. Shouldn't this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan has bound for 18 years?" You can see here clearly Jesus is saying demons are a representative of Satan. They are his essence. They come from him. They obey him. They do what they're told. And in this particular case, Satan or somebody under Satan had commissioned this spirit of infirmity to attack this woman and get inside her body and cause her this painful, gut-wrenching disability. Man, she was really hurt and in an enormous amount of pain. What Jesus says to the pastor, again, remember, if you decide to get into a healing or deliverance ministry, and hopefully yours starts today, you got to remember that sinners are not going to oppose that. They're going to actually look into it and be interested in it. Sinners are not your problem. The biggest problem are the churches. The churches that have apostated themselves, the pastors who've got yellow streaks down their back, that are looking for security and money and accolades. These useless, worthless, gutless pastors need to be farmed out and eviscerated. They've ruined the gospel, and they have helped turn America into a cesspool of sin. That's what America is now. It's a cesspool of stinking, rot gut sin. It's utterly amazing, and it's 100% the fault of the church. Well, Jesus dresses down this pastor and explains to him, "Hey, what do you think you're doing here? You're off the track." Right? And then it says, his adversaries were ashamed. Okay? That's interesting, isn't it? Not only was this pastor Jesus's adversary, but there were several people in the synagogue that day that were tracking him. They were his adversaries. So you had a mixed bag there. You had true followers. You had the people there who loved Jehovah, and they wanted the good things of God. And then you always have the tares mixed in there. There it is. You'd have the good and the bad, and in the pastor's case, the ugly. But they're all mixed up. And so Jesus is ministering to all the groups. He singles out the pastor first, then the adversaries, it says, were ashamed after he explained to them that this woman was also a daughter of Abraham, just like they were, and that they're hypocrites. And shouldn't she be delivered since the great physician is here today? Shouldn't she be delivered from Satan's bondage? Now remember, not all diseases or illnesses or sicknesses or trauma is caused by demons, but the net result of it is demons either cause it or exacerbate it. So if you get into an accident and you get injured, that's not a demonic illness. That was a trauma event. It doesn't matter. The demons use trauma events to accelerate them and worsen them and exacerbate them. They make it worse. So even if the spirit doesn't cause a sickness, they are frequently and often behind the sickness, making it worse and keeping it from healing. They block people's healings. And these spirit of infirmities, they are absolute masters at it. Blocking your healing, nothing works. Physical therapy, cortisone shots, surgery, nothing. All medical treatments fail. That's when you know, you can be pretty sure that there's a spirit of infirmity behind this mess. And then after this event happens, it says, verse 18, then Jesus said to them, okay, this happened at the same service. After this lady was healed and after she went through her praise period, and after Jesus straightened out his adversaries and his pastor, he stayed at the same service and kept teaching, right? He was teaching after that. And then he explains something fascinating. He says, you put a grain of mustard seed in the ground and it starts growing. And initially it goes fast. And then eventually, if it's not destroyed, it becomes some great gigantic fig tree. And then he says, the fowls of the air lodge in the branches of the fig tree. Wow. He's talking about that pastor and the adversaries that were at that synagogue service, and he spoke a parable illustrating them. So he goes from the disabled woman to Satan to his adversaries, all in the same service. All in the same service. They're the fowls of the air that lodge in the branches. Always remember, I try my best to get my YouTube listeners to develop what I used to call terror cells, where you open up a small group of people in your church, and it only needs to start scripturally, it starts with two or three. And you open up a terror cell and you start hunting down the sick people in your church. And when you find them, you take them aside, maybe to another location, and you minister to them, and you minister deliverance, and you minister healing to them. And then after that person is delivered or healed, then they go back and tell different peoples. And pretty soon you've got this whole new ministry cropping up inside your church. And that will go on for a period of time until you get caught. And then they'll throw you out of your church. That's a good sign. It's definitely a blessing, because that means God wants you to start your own ministry. And that exact same thing happened to me years ago. I was at the Dream Center, which is a mega church. Assembly of God mega church in Scottsdale. And this exact thing happened to me. Exactly happened to me. And I'm at the Arizona Deliverance Center right now as a result of it. And as I said, you can watch our services every Friday and Saturday, youtube.com/houseofhealingAZ. And last night, Friday night service, 2 nights ago, a woman brought her disabled daughter to the service. She was in a wheelchair. And while several of my ministry partners were praying for the lady in the wheelchair, I took the mother up to the front of the altar. And then I found out that she had a lot of soul wounds and a lot of fears because of her daughter's future and her medical condition. She was scared for her daughter. Well, the Holy Spirit just jumped right on her, and all kinds of spirits of fear and dread came out of her right at that moment. And then I went over to pray for somebody else. And as I was walking by, I overheard one of our ministry workers praying against a bad back. I didn't know she had a bad back. So I came back over and I said to her, "You got a bad back?" She said, "Yeah, I had a," I can't remember what it was, "a fusion." I had some kind of a, I don't remember how many levels it was. Maybe she didn't even tell me. It could have been a 2 or 3, what have you. She had had a low back fusion. And she had a little altered gait. Her hips were tilted this way. Her back kind of bent that way. And she was in chronic pain. Okay, so I prayed for her the first time, and she wasn't healed. So then I prayed for her the second time, and she wasn't healed again. Strike two. So I figured, hey, this has got to be a spirit of infirmity. This isn't a disability. She had a plate in her back. And I did something I rarely have ever done before. I reached around her and I grabbed her in a big bear hug. And I was holding her pretty tight. The reason for that was she was starting to get shaky. She had been walking, trying to walk out her faith and get healed, and it wasn't working. Her back was not healed. So I was holding her, and I was kind of holding her up, and I was praying for her at the same time. And while I'm holding her, I'm thinking in my mind, spirit of infirmity, you know, you got to come out of there. This is it. I'm holding on. You're out. And suddenly, it was weird. I felt something going up the woman's back, and it went under my arms, up higher to her shoulders, and went out. And as soon as it went out, the woman went limp, and so I caught her. I was holding her up, and she started crying harder. She was crying earlier because of chronic pain and fear. This sounded different, and I says to her, "I think you're healed," or something like that, and she's crying, and it looked like tears of joy. And I said, "Go ahead and take a few steps and start walking again." She started walking. I literally saw her hips level out. Boom, just like that. Leveled out right in front of my eyes. And her spine went, it was bent, and it stood right up. It was amazing. Other people saw it, and the woman started walking around Friday night in the front of the altar. And everybody started cheering. And her healing got a standing ovation. Everybody was amazed. And the Teen Challenge guys were there Friday night, and they were flabbergasted as well. But again, the point is that every time you have the moving of the Spirit, you're going to have adversaries in the same service, or you're going to have the pastor or the church board or the elders or what have you. Some of them are going to be against what you're doing, okay? And that happens in almost every service. We don't have a lot of it at the Deliverance Center because people know what we do when they come there. But you're going to face this adversity no matter what you do, and you are to ignore it and press forward. You always ignore the difficulties of your trials and your tribulations. You always take them as learning experiences, and then you just keep moving forward. Even if you falter and stumble, I've done it myself, of course, you get back up quickly, and then you move forward. You're always moving forward. Okay? You're not going to be alive much longer. You live a very short life. Trust me, I know all about it. I'm an old man now. or an older person, I should say. And I can remember just like yesterday when I was in college. I can, clear as a bell, can remember what I was doing, where I was decades ago. Time goes by so fast, you can't even believe it. That's why Paul said, you have got to redeem the time. Redeem the time. Now, these spirits of infirmity, they are stubborn things. And prior to praying for this woman, she had gone through deliverance on the other side of the deliverance center. And I got her to forgive her ex-husband, who was kind of had abandoned their daughter, who was in the wheelchair up there. And she had built up some resentment and pain and disappointment over her ex, the daughter's father. And when she repented of that, evil spirits started jumping right out of her. It just instantly happened. They just started coming out. And so she had already repented of bitterness and unforgiveness before I gave her the bear hug. So the groundwork, so to speak, had been done. I said that to say this. Most of these joint issues I've noticed over the years are related to unforgiveness, bitterness, and ought. The Greek word is aites. It means to have a yucky feeling about somebody that you don't like or hurt you in the past. That's ought. It's different from unforgiveness because unforgiveness is an attitude issue. It's a mental issue. It's a choice issue. You can, by faith, in obedience to God, forgive someone for what they did to you. But if you still have ought against that person, it can block your healing. And most of the people that you're working with, most of them that have joint issues, arthritis, fibromyalgia, I've seen, I don't know, 50 cases of that instantly healed. Fibromyalgia, those are usually caused by fear spirits, rejection demons, unforgiveness, ought. I've seen them instantly healed. Just, it's very common to see fibromyalgia healed. But these joint issues, generally speaking, in my experience, they are related somehow to people that have some kind of ought or, you know, bitterness or resentment or bad memories, or they rehearse negative thoughts in their mind when they think of that person or when they see that person. This ought thing can block your healing and it won't come out. You see, it's like a cork in a bottle and you don't get that new wine coming out. It's corked up because you've got ought against some rotten, you know what, in your past, who betrayed you and stabbed you in the back, hurt you, stole from you, left you, abandoned you, whatever it may be. Okay? You have to forgive that person, and you have got to get that ought out of there. And Friday night, we had already done that with this lady. She had ought against her ex. And exes are extremely dangerous. It's very common for people to have ought and unforgiveness and bitterness toward an ex, because ex-lovers, ex-fiancés, ex-wives, ex-husbands, exes, at one time you were in love with, you thought they loved you, you were friends, you had a positive relationship in the past, and that makes the pain even worse because it's flipped. It used to be positive, and it flipped to abuse. Okay? It flipped over to abuse. And so the person that abused you, I know this sounds crazy, was an instrument or tool of Satan to injure your soul, and your soul is where your emotions come out of. They injured your soul, and they damaged you because you took an offense. And that allowed joint problems to either start or exacerbate, and they got worse. It's very similar to what Jesus said. You got a church of believers, but in that group, in that church, literally almost every church, there are tares in there. Tares. Yike. And that's what bitterness and unforgiveness and ought is. It's a tear growing in the church, you know, a weed. It's a foul that lodges in the branches. And it just hides there sometimes and doesn't say anything. That's what birds do sometimes. They're in a branch and they're stone quiet. You don't even see them. You don't know they're there. But they manifest at exactly the point the devil wants them to manifest, to cause a church split, cause disruption, cause disunity, cause you emotional and mental pain. That's the purpose of a tear. It's a purpose of a foul. And that's the purpose of bitterness. The spirit of infirmity uses bitterness and ought and unforgiveness as his fuel, as his power. And it gradually weakened this woman over 18 years. Can you imagine that? 18 years she's down here. She was there 19 years ago. But the demon had taken her through this process. 18 years of it. Okay? Now, obviously, if you're in an abusive relationship right now, and I've counseled dozens of people over the years, if there's a safety issue involved or a severe emotional abuse case, you've got to get some separation. You've got to temporarily separate. You've got to somehow get out from under that immediate abuse. Okay? You can't just sit there and let somebody hit you in the head with a hammer. But either now or later, you are going to have to face it. Whatever they did to you, and it doesn't matter what they did to you. What's the worst thing it could have done to you? Damaged, hurt, or killed one of your kids. That's probably at the top, particularly if you're a mother. Okay. Either now or later, you got to get this through your thick noggin, as my granddad used to say. You're going to have to forgive that person. And you're going to have to remove that ought from your soul. Your soul is where your emotions reside. And your soul is where the wounds and the hurts reside. The spirit man is where your relationship with God resides. The anointing, the Holy Spirit, it's all in your spirit man. But your soul man is the one that damages people. And the devil loves to use your soul to damage you. He does it all the time. Right? And if you have aught against someone, if you have unforgiveness against somebody, the best time to get it out is on the Zoom services on Tuesday and Wednesday night. You don't even have to show your face on the Zoom. While they're praying, while somebody else is getting healed, you just follow the same pattern on your own. You put your hands on your body and you repent. You confess your ought. You confess your unforgiveness. That's an absolute requirement with God. You have to confess it out loud. Confess it out loud. Then you got to repent of it and ask for forgiveness for it and apologize to God for what you were carrying in your body that allowed that spirit of infirmity to enrage itself and bind your joints. In some cases, these demons are so powerful, they bend your joints like they did to that poor lady in Luke chapter 13. Okay? This is how the system works. This is how you can get healed. Friday night, after that lady had gotten healed, she was crying tears of joy, and all she kept saying was, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And what was the purpose of the healing? Because when the woman in Luke 13, when she got healed, she stood straight up. She glorified God. That's the purpose of it, because obviously the great physician heals. I don't have no healing powers. I'm fresh out of them. In fact, I never had them. Let you in on a little secret there. That's a secret. I never had any healing powers. I don't have nothing. the whole thing is Christ the healer. It is the great physician. And I did the same thing Friday night, this exact process I went through. I propped the lady up, so to speak, in the front of the church. I announced that she was now the Arizona Deliverance Center's worship leader, and she was to take the rest of the people there through worship. And she went with it wholeheartedly and excitedly, praising Jesus, and everybody else was praising him. And I was praising him, obviously, and thanking him for this wonderful healing. Now, do you have something wrong with your body, particularly a joint issue? Okay, it's probably a spirit of infirmity. What happened was you tried to get healed using every method you possibly could. You went to a witch doctor, a chiropractor, a naturopath, a healer, a shaman, you went to YouTube, you went through a bunch of stuff on YouTube. Nothing works. Okay, now it's a red flag that you tried medicine, physical therapy, surgeries, medications, what have you. Nothing's working. If nothing is working, now not every illness obviously is a spirit of infirmity. Everything's not demons. But if you've tried everything else and nothing's working and you see your joints kind of morphing, they're bending, clunk like that, there you go. That is a spirit of infirmity. That's a spirit of infirmity. You can get him out of there. That thing came out Friday night. It was really something special. How do you do it? You just do it like this. Lord Jesus, so-and-so abused me and degraded me and hurt me. And I took offense at it. I developed ought over it. I had bad feelings for that person. I don't like them. And I repent of it today. I repent of it and I ask you to forgive them and to bless them. Thus saith the Lord, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, pray for those who despitefully use you. And if you can do that sincerely or keep doing it until you are sincere about it, that spirit of infirmity had a grip on you, but it's loosening as you're praying. It'll loosen as you're praying. And the next step is, you use your authority that God gave you, Mark 16, Matthew 28, Luke 24. It's all right there. Matthew 18, Luke chapter 10. All these verses are screaming at you. You have the authority now to get that spirit of infirmity out of there if you have repented. If you have not repented, you're going to have it until you're lying in a care center somewhere and people are coming to say hi to you every once in a while. Most of the time, they don't even come back. But that's where you're going to end up, in a care center. And that's not God's will. Not at all. Friday night was part one on divine healing. And I gave numerous revelations, many of which no one's ever heard before. The next seminar is part two of divine healing. That is something you're not going to miss for December. Tremendous insights into the mysterious world of being healed. And one of those insights I've shared with you today, it is the spirit of infirmity. He is your enemy, and you are to destroy him, and you are to be well. Okay? You can be crying tears of joy like this lady in Luke 13, or the lady Friday night at the Arizona Deliverance Center. Same Holy Ghost that performed both miracles. It's the same Jesus that did both miracles. The one, he was actually present there in human form. Obviously, he's not like that anymore. But the Holy Ghost was there in Luke 13. He was there at the Deliverance Center. Either way, if you repent and you forgive and you get that ought removed out of there and you cast that ought out of there, and you renounce it, you turn against it. Once you've gotten rid of that ought for that person that abused you, it's usually an ex, right? Or a parent. Or a current spouse, actually. That happens quite often, too, as you well know. Once that's gone, Why not do what I did? I just grabbed the woman and the spirit in her body apparently somehow felt uncomfortable with me grabbing her. Something happened. The anointing was moving. She was maybe believing in her mind. Something happened. I don't know exactly what happened. And that thing just came up, went north, and boom, out. And she was healed. And mind you, that was a back fusion. Okay, that wasn't a muscle strain or sciatica. That was a fusion that got healed. It was a remarkable miracle. You can see it on our YouTube channel right now after the podcast if you're going to go watch it. You can hear me talking to her. You can see my mistakes. You can see the things I did right. I leave my mic on so everybody can have a learning experience. And that's important too. If you go to the youtube.com/houseofhealingaz, you have got a shot at getting that spirit of infirmity out of your body. All right. Please come and see me at the Deliverance Center. We're downtown on 15th Avenue, just south of Osborn Road. Please contact me on my email, mike@hardcorechristianity.com. Remember, the Bible requires you to confess your sins and repent of it. The Greek word is metanoeo. It means to make an about face. If you're still doing the sin, you haven't repented. Well, Brother Mike, I repent every day. No, you're being deceived by demons. You have not repented. You did not repent. Repentance means to stop doing it and go back the other direction. It was a term used in the military, metanoeo. You know, you're marching this way and you turn around and march back. You got to repent of your sins. If you keep those negative emotions, if you keep saying those negative things, if you keep rehearsing over and over in your mind those negative thoughts, you are bound. You will never be delivered. You will never be healed. Okay? I'm warning you, your blood is not on my hands. Okay? But if you repent and you change, you're getting healed. No question. See you next time.